Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back here to the American Dota 2 League. It is going to be day one in a two-game series between the Houses Down and Union Gaming here in Group B. Thank you so much for joining us here. Brought to you by SteelSeries, casted by, of course, High Ground TV. With me tonight is none other than Kyle Guy. How are you doing, sir?
Mod, I'm doing fantastic. Finally happy to get this game going underway. We were patient for it. I appreciate everyone else out there being patient, but also we do have one additional small special guest, Mr. Greg What Is It TV, will be joining us on the stats, so apologies ahead of time.
Yeah, if he screws it up, feel free to flame in chat. Feel free to give him your utmost best. Yeah, tweet him. Yes. Send him emails. Hate mails even would be fantastic. Let's see if he even knows how to do stats at this point, but... enough about Greg, as we are going to jump into the game, and already we have a bit of a disconnect, and we might have that from time to time. In fact, somebody in the lobby disconnected, we had to get a stand in real quick, that's why we had that kind of bit of a waiting period after I kind of threw up the overlay and stuff like that, so apologies for that, but we are going to jump into the series. We've already had one great series, that was a North American contest between Osiris as well as Ban Earth Spirit or No Earth Spirit, and now we get to see some of that South American flavor, Cuddle Guy.
Oh yeah, that spicy salsa verde flavor. I'm excited for it. The Houses Down, the Brazilian squad going to be taking on Union Gaming, the Peruvian group. And we'll just go ahead and put it out there ahead of time. The Peruvians and Brazilians, sometimes we'll have some pauses here and there. I believe we're sporting the server on the US East, so there could be difficulties. Just want to put out the forewarning. If you want, we can make a drinking game out of it. They throw up the pause, you throw up that drink.
Yeah, absolutely, guys. And I mean, at this point in time, it's like 9 o'clock at night, 10 o'clock at night, of course, on a Monday. So feel free, grab a beer, grab a bite to eat as well. Stick around. We've got a couple of games to go. Like I said, a two-game series. Now, to remind you guys, this is the ADL. There is $10,000 in prize pool on the line here for first place, obviously getting the majority of that prize in the playoffs. Of course, if you'd like to be part of the action, you can purchase up the ticket, $3.99 in the Dota store, coming with its very own HUD, obviously, and it would help us a lot as well. Once again, I'm Malt with me as Cuddle Guy. We're into the draft already. Nagasaran picked up first for Union Gaming. Looks like we'll see a bit of that Rat Dota come out. That quick ratings, potentially, it could be support, but more likely than not, Cuddle Guy, probably going to be that carry.
Yeah, well, this could lead to a bunch of different things. Obviously, it's a great pickup in its own right. Very flexible. You could throw it as a support to fall back on, put him in the mid lane, RTZ, Miracle style, what have you. But also a great grab to get early because you still have a Batrider in the pool, and Naga works excellent against the Batrider. So if the house is down, take the bait and grab that Batrider. Remaining. You know, it could come back to bite him in the ass.
Yeah,
we'll see if that's the case.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you 100%. And, you know, it's so tempting, though, to pick that hero, especially to pick it first. But like we saw in the last game, Disruptor can be very effective against that hero. And like you already talked about, Naga Siren and Snare Song of the Siren to really just make sure, like, let's hold on a second. Let's think about what we're doing here. Let's talk about this team fight. Let's get together, have a powwow, and then back off together. So Union Gaming, they have that potential. What are they going to combine up with it? They need some kind of early game aggression, maybe in the safe lane if they're going to go for that Naga mid. Naga needs a lot of time to come up online, so you get a safe lane farmer who's going to take a, you know, just to be a bit aggressive, kind of like a Viper, a Slark, something along those lines, whereas instead you would go normally for somebody that's a bit of a harder carry. Still, THG, 1 minute and 10 seconds left of reserve time. They're really thinking about this pick here, or at least these two picks. No Lycan, they have an Ancient Apparition, they have a Dazzle that they can pick towards if they want to. I'm hoping, because this is South American Dota, we see a bit kind of a crazier pick. They go for a Centaur Warrider, a bit aggressive, and I certainly like that against the Naga.
Yep, and still kind of cookie cutter. You know, it doesn't give too much away. Not too surprised they want to get up that foundation, get a nice, strong offlaner. At least as far as we're concerned, it will be an offlaner. We already touched base on him. A great guy who was able to take a lot of punishment. You could throw him an early set of boots or a stout shield, whatever you, with the help of the return. He could take a lot of punishment in that off lane, but still keep on getting that CS and still hang around close enough to build that XP. Nice, I like this. The quick grab of the Rubick, a great support to pick up against the Naga Siren, makes for easy song grabs. And I mean, just recently, I think they threw up on Reddit the great play of TI2, where that Rubick and the Naga steal the song. It was so beautiful.
Yeah.
So we might get to see a little bit of that.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I'm a big fan of Rubik's that can get that song going, just kind of have that counter initiation or have that song to be able to use when you're trying to go in for a team fight or something along those lines. Plus, I mean, he's good. He's got Telekinesis. Fade Bolt is nice as well to deal with some of those illusions. And obviously, I think one of the most underrated things to think about is the Null Field, because you do have to deal with potential radiance burn damage. So magic resistance for your team is never anything to really kind of turn your head at. On the other side of things, though, Dazzle coming out, he is the opposite of real magic. He's got mostly physical damage, and obviously, the Shallow Grave, you can't say enough about it. A hero that has a lot of utility, and suddenly we see an Ancient Apparition not only get through the first round of picks, but maybe even the first round of bans and the second round of bans as well.
I wouldn't mind seeing Ancient Apparition in this game. He was banned out both games very quickly in the previous series, Motten. I'm always a big fan of him. The Chilling Touch early game does devastating damage. The Ice Blast, just tremendous, like, fight initiation. Great way to pick off heroes very quickly. I mean, the man is so cold, he eats ice cream to warm up.
That's how cold that Ancient Apparition is, and he's a million years old or something along those lines from the lore of Dota, I'm sure. I mean, someone would know better than I would, obviously, but a fun hero nonetheless, and just an easy hero to play as well. Just put the Chilling Touch down. I mean, some of the snipes can be kind of hard with your ultimate. If you're further away, it's going to help out, obviously, but I don't know, man, this next ban, it's not going to be the AA. He's ready to be picked up here, whether that's THG or Union Gaming. Remains to be seen, but THG, they've got the option if they want to.
Union Gaming still off to obviously get up that offlaner. Nyx Assassin is still in the pool. Obviously, the house is down, unable to capitalize on picking up the Batrider for themselves. Don't even want to give the Peruvians the opportunity to get it for them. So they ban it outright. They also ban out the Clockwork, but they are leaving a Nyx Assassin, which is also, I would say, right there as the next best option for your offlane.
Yeah, I'd agree 100%. There is still that Nyx Assassin to go for. And when you think about offlanes right now, it's generally those three, Centaur, Batrider, and the Nyx Assassin. You'll see a Clockwork from time to time. You'll see a couple other heroes from time to time. But as it stands, I mean, it's usually those three. And so with the Nyx Assassin and with the Ancient Apparition, maybe that's what they're thinking about now. They might go for something a bit more unorthodox than maybe something they've been practicing with and kind of a pocket strategy. But that remains to be seen. They're going to pick the Luna instead, which I don't know if they needed to thoroughly pick that. I don't know if that was the best idea to pick at that point.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of gives away a little bit more of what they're going to be rolling with. Obviously, it's looking like a, you know, safe lane, tri lane with the help of that Rubick right there to kind of babysit out, even though Rubick is kind of one of those heroes that's also notorious to roam around and maybe put some aggression on other lanes. Now, it might be a bit questionable if he leaves the Luna on her own, you know, and if the Union Gaming decide to pick up any sort of rotation on their own part, they could put a real threat on this Luna. I mean, as it stands right now,
5 seconds remaining.
She doesn't quite know who she's going to be going against in the off lane, so Union Gaming now have the option to see what they want to do to contest her.
Yeah, even go for an aggressive tri lane with the Dazzle, that could certainly be very strong. I mean, you can have a very aggressive tri lane just with maybe, like I said, somebody, a hero that does work. I mean, you can even have a Slaughter up there if you really wanted to, a hero we don't see too often. I'm just surprised there's no Nyx Assassin yet, there's no Ancient Apparition yet. We keep going back to that point, but for good reason. I mean, like, those are two very damn good heroes. Those are heroes that are going to do work in a game. So
maybe the South Americans are not big AA fans. They love the heat. They don't need the, you know, Cool Breeze, Ancient Apparition, or what have you.
Yeah, the DK is actually going to promote that fact with his Breathe Fire. He's a very, very hot hero.
Spicy.
Very. Yeah, that's
suave.
Yeah, exactly. Union Gaming with that spicy meatball kind of Dragonite coming out. And this is interesting because now you're kind of saying, well, where's this Naga going? Because when you see a DK, you're generally going to be like, that's not a safe lane DK. He's not the best as a safe lane farmer. He could be. I mean, it certainly works. We've seen it from time to time. But he's better as a mid laner. And we don't know who's going mid yet for THG either. So all of these picks, I guess, are going to come down to who picks last, who's going to pick what last. You see THG pick up the Shadow Shaman. They have two great roaming supports with the Rubick and the Shadow Shaman in terms of you have Spell Steal, you have Serpent Wards as well to push things down and to be aggressive later on. I like THG's lineup right now. Union Gaming, they're trying to fit in this DK early on, and this is one of those heroes, like I talked about, that will be aggressive early, but I don't know if it's as aggressive as they want to be, like as something like a Slark would be or something. I don't know.
5 seconds remaining.
Sorry about that. I was hitting my mic toggle a little too much right there. But we also need to see where this Naga is going to end up going. I mean, she still could be a support. She still could be a mid. She still could be, you know, whatever it is. But I am liking houses down. I like picking the Luna against the Naga. Obviously, your Glaive works so nice, clearing out all the extra illusions and stuff. So we'll see, though. This next pick on Union Gaming is going to give away a lot of information.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they only have a little bit of reserve time right now. They've got to pick something up. Shadow Shaman, he has, and you talked about the glaives, but also there's the Rubick with Fadebolt, like I talked about. There's the Shadow Shaman with Aethershock. So illusion clearing is not actually an issue this game, whereas it usually is. Outworld Devourer coming out for Union Gaming right now, and now it seems like, if anything, this OD is going to be mid or safe lane, DK is going to be mid or safe lane, and then Naga's going to be support, which kind of throws a monkey wrench into the plan of Union Gaming if they pick up the Naga Siren first. So it's very interesting they decided to do that. And even questionable.
10 seconds. Yeah, I mean, I would imagine now it has to be a pretty support-heavy Naga Siren. Otherwise, you're going to start getting way too greedy with this, and that just doesn't seem to work out well. We'll see how they decide to change it up. I mean, I guess they can run the Dragon Knight in mid or the safe lane. So be it. I mean, now the house is down, are left scratching their head as what they want to actually contest in the mid lane. You have two different sides of the spectrum with the Dragon Knight and the Outward Devourer, rather. They're not going to be sure what they're going to be going up against. We might even see houses down remaining. Go aggressive very early in the game, like try to scout things out, run through the jungle, maybe get an early pickoff just to see a little bit of information as what they'll be going against in these lanes.
Right, yeah. Maybe send something aggressive and then decide from there what you're going to do. Some 5-man aggression into that offlane real quick, see what's going on. I definitely agree. They certainly need some information. And I think this last pick, more than anything, will tell you what's going to be going on here, because I think they need an offlaner. THG going for Razor, a very strong pick, I think, up against the Outworld Devourer if they send him mid. And pretty okay against the DK as well, honestly. Steal that damage from him. He won't be able to right-click. Yes, you can get last hits with Wreath Fire, but Razor, so good at that right-click stealing, and it's just one of those heroes that's nice to have. We used to see him a whole lot, but as of recently, not so much. But I think he works in this lineup, because you have a Centaur who's extending fights very long with the Stampede. He's getting stomps, you have Razor shackling up, and all of a sudden that Eye of the Storm and the damage that Razor is dealing is starting to mount up, so little by little, whittling the enemy team down, which I love, and I think THG's lineup is kind of built and primed for that.
Yeah, it's definitely a direct counter back getting that Razor going against the Outworld, and I think that's part of the reason we haven't seen Razor too much lately, is we also haven't seen the OD too much lately. A lot of people have been going for the Invokers and Storm Spirits, Pucks, and what have you, and they just find better options instead when you can grab an Outworld and get easily countered back. So we'll see if that pays off for Houses Down. And Union Gaming, the Peruvian squad, they're going to finish things up by grabbing up the Timbersaw, another hero we don't get to see too often, but he doesn't really have any counters in this game. There's no Nyx Assassin or anything like that, so I guess they feel pretty confident he could try to snowball into this one, but another kind of greedy pickup.
I think this draft is so good for THG, because Timbersaw is just, he's not as tanky as he used to be, and in a lineup against Rubick Shadow Shaman and the Luna, Rubick Shadow Shaman and the Luna, he's going to fall very quickly. So on top of that, Union Gaming, they can run an aggro tri lane. I just don't see them doing that, because it's a lot less strong than I think THG's. I think you have, I mean, if you get a level or two in the DK, he'll have Dragon Tail slash Breathe Fire, but you have to like decide what you're going to do there. But Ewo is going to be on the OD, so he might be the safe lane farmer. Then again, he won't get experience if that's the case. So I think it is going to be a defensive tri-lane coming out from, Jericho, Nova, and Citadel, but we'll wait to see as we jump into the game, ladies and gentlemen. It's series number 2 here on day 1 of the American Dota League. It's been great to cast this for you thus far, guys, and we're going to get into another series here in just a second. We'll get some introductions, obviously, for THD. We've got Neofolk up on the Luna here, heading towards the mid lane as of right now, but probably going to go top. Down bottom, Zoidberg going to be on the Centaur Warrunner, and it looks like they are going to try to scout things out here just in case they make sure things are going their way. AKA Faka the Sandin will be on the Rubick. We'll have GSX 1000R on the Shadow Shaman. We'll have 1987, another Sandin on the Razor to round out THD.
And if you are playing the drinking game, go ahead and throw one up right now as we get our first pause of this particular matchup. With that said, I'll go ahead and move on to Union Gaming side on the front, leading the front right now in the bottom lane. We got Jericho playing on your Dazzle. Right behind him, it's going to be Naga Siren. It's going to be played by Nova, and it looks potentially like it could be accompanied with... I'm trying to look in the fountain. There it is. It's Odie, who's hanging way far back right now. Played by Mr. IWO. Mid lane, it's going to be the Dragon Knight, played by none other Citadel. And of course, finally, in the top off lane, we got PMJPS or Gyps playing your Timbersaw.
And yeah, so this is interesting. The Black of the South used to be playing for Arctic and, of course, for Force with Revenge. Now on Union Gamers here, he's going to be farming in that safe lane, not going to be getting the experience that he might like to have. And that's interesting, because I don't know, as an OD, if you need that much farm, you really need the experience here. And he's not going to be getting that in a tri lane unless his team is pulling for him. But the problem is already So since your ward coming out from THG, making sure they might throw a ward up here and just block this camp real quick. Okay, let's see, what do we got here from Greg, the first stat of the game?
That's pretty boring, Greg.
Let's step it up, dude. Step it up, man. You've got better.
The current record's 2-1, guys. Thanks.
Actually, that's actually pretty cool to know. So, in terms of South American battles right now, THT do have the edge here heading into this game, and it's always nice to see the stat lines against teams that play against each other a lot, especially teams that people don't necessarily see too often. So, we'll see how it goes. We have another pause. That's another
drink number two, everyone. Throw it on back.
Yep. For those of you drinking shots, good luck. I'm sure you might not be feeling too good after this one, but let's check the pings real quick while we have a second. I'm sure that we might see some high pings. Well, there's like 300,000 people in the lobby also, so that might be an issue. Myself, what is hippin', of course, Coddle Guy having pretty decent pings overall, but then you look at, of course, the teams, and they're sitting on 200. Daylin, the Spanish caster, sitting on a 400 right now, so rip to his casting experience. Some people sitting on 229, even the Ukrainian caster sitting on right about 200. So it's really just, I think, a lot of it's the Brazilian issue. I think Peru is doing okay. If you look at UG, they're sitting about 150 or so. A couple of them are sitting at 200, but yeah, that's not very fun, is it?
I'm not too sure my geography mod is no bueno, if you will, and I'm not too sure if it would have been better off they just tried to use a Brazilian server or not, or if then we would have had a bad connection or what have you, but there just always seems to be little problems, you know, from time to time, and I did forewarn about it. You know, it's just gonna happen. It just does. But
the way,
hopefully it happens.
Somebody posted a Reddit thread on this, and the way I understand the South American servers are that Brazilians have an okay ping to the Brazilian server, but other South American countries like Peru or Argentina, for that matter, to the Brazilian server have a worse ping than they do to US East. I believe that's correct. Correct me if I'm wrong, anybody, but somebody did make a Reddit thread about that, and that seems to be the case, and that's probably why we're playing US East. Whereas if it were two Brazilian teams, for example, we might be on Brazilian server, which would be 100% fine, obviously. There's no qualms about that, but I think that's the issue, and server issues are going to be in Dota until the end of time, until at least servers and you know, latency have become a thing of the past, but of course, that's until Google Fiber kind of takes over the world and has...
Oh, and I hope that day comes soon. Well, trust me on that. I think
you and every gamer on the face of the earth, you're just like, please, can we just get Google Fiber in our hometown? That would be excellent, you know, like...
I would give anything to throw my Time Warner modem out the window.
Mm, you and me both, my friend. Shout out to Time Warner. Hope we don't get in trouble for that, but that's okay.
they're like, I'm tuning into this Dota stream and they're talking shit about my company. Shut down their internet right now.
Yeah, that's like, I'm actually paranoid about that. I'm not even kidding. Like, oh God, no, please don't. They're hearing this. Don't shut my modem down during the cast.
Nice. Very nice.
So, what do we got going on here?
Well, we got a brief rough draft of what looks like the lanes, and we didn't really get to talk about it yet. And finally, the G's are actually thrown out conveniently enough. Hopefully, we'll get more gameplay than pause play.
Look here at the bottom lane. They're actually hiding AK Faka and GSX 1000R. They're looking for First Blood with Centaur Warrunner. And I don't think they'll stay very long after they get First Blood if they get it, because Centaur is another hero that, again, needs levels. They can stay and try to contest farm, and that's fine. I don't know if you need to, though. So we'll see. Really interesting. I mean, I know Ewell can farm. We'll see how it goes for him as he, of course, starts things off here. The DK mid is going to be interesting. He can get his damage stats. I think they just wanted to dodge the DK, or the Razor mid for the OD, because that would be a pretty awful matchup for him. That would not be a surprise to me. But we have to keep our eye on bottom lane. There's already going to be that intelligent steal coming out from the Astral Prison.
No grave.
Jericho. Jericho, dude. Oh, there's going to be telekinesis into the stomp. Nicely done. No double to follow it up. But look at the Aether Shock damage. There's First Blood. Those sneaky fools. They sat in the trees. They got First Blood. They've accomplished what they wanted to accomplish. And now, maybe head out of here. They're going to roam mid. It looks like maybe head up to the top lane. Centaur got a level out of that. He is going to be a bit safer now with one of those heroes dead.
Hook, line, and sinker from Centaur Warrunner. He played it nice and a little bit aggressive, forcing Dazzle to probably first pick. I didn't notice if he had waited on skilling or not, but he went into the poison touch thinking he could play very aggressive in the lane, but once that party popped out of the woods and came on him, he had nothing to do to survive, so he just had to hand himself over. So, quick work early. THD picking up the first kill.
Yeah, absolutely. But while that's all happening, you do have Outworld Devourer getting a decent amount of last hits. He's at 7 right now. And the thing is, if he goes for an early Midas, he certainly can become that hard carry people are, you know, people expect to see out of that safe lane farmer. So with Ewell getting, you know, at least some decent CS here, we'll see if they can make something happen. They're looking for a gank potentially mid. GSX is going to go on him. Citadel has to go around the side here into the trees and back his way out of there, but still safe and sound for the time being. In terms of the mid matchup, Razor's definitely winning 7-2 against 4-1.
It's not as dominant of a performance as you would probably see in a standard Razor versus OD, so they're definitely happy to put this trade. Dragonite's going to hold strong. Hopefully see if Mr. 1987 wants to adventure away from the mid lane at some point, and that way Dragonite would be able to pop his level 6 and try to acquire that mid lane tower very quickly.
Yeah, and we probably will see 1987 go for a gank or two here and there, depending on the room. Top lane, getting caught out. Timbersaw, he's getting low in health, but he actually has no point in the reactive armor. He does have a point into that timber chain. They're still chasing him right now, looking for shackles. He doesn't actually have it. He's only level 1 and only has Aether Shock here. Now he's wrapping around. PMJPS is going to look for maybe a timber chain away. He's going to try to fight on GSX. GSX is alone here, and there's going to be the rolling death. I don't think he can get this kill, but PMGPS has got to be very careful here.
Yep, he's running back. I mean, thank goodness he has these boots at least to get away from this one. Pops back with the salve, trying to lay out a little bit of aggression on the Shadow Shaman, but he will step back. But we do have a nearby Rubick here plotting. Maybe I can secretly catch him out and throw him on the cliff, even though Timber, I guess, could technically timber chain away if he gets caught out there. But regardless, it's the long road all the way back to the lane where Luna has been farming very safe and soundly.
Yeah, but the problem with this is that Timber's already level 3, and the supports, they don't have many levels on them. They're still level 1, so they wasted a lot of time not getting any experience, and I'm sure Timbersaw's probably fine with that. He probably doesn't mind that he missed out on a little bit of experience while he was just running around the jungle. Now we're getting some time to pull for these supports. GSX is going to pull, and there was already a stack there. All the meanwhile, Centaur down bottom, getting harassed a bit, but he's still fine. They cannot kill him because, honestly, Nova and Ewo don't do much. Nova actually went for the mirror images instead of the Riptide as that support Naga Siren.
It's a bit of an interesting getup right now. So, I mean, if they're not getting anything done, it's just their purpose is just blah. I mean, I feel like to achieve success in this lane, it would be ideal to grab the Centaur and get a hold of him, but he's just what we always talk about in the draft. This is a guy who's way too hard to bring down right now, and he did go with the boots kind of a get up, so it's going to be hard to lock him down. For now, we'll just kind of harass him out with the Astral Imprisonments. In the meantime, we'll control the CS in the lane for sure, but if he happens to get to level 6 and he gets a little bit of a hand from his team, they can run the lane right back. But top lane, they're going on Timbersaw. I got it the last second. It looks like he tried to timber chain away, and a Lucent Beam was enough to finish him off, but a little too overzealous in the lane.
Yeah, and that's like I said, man. He does not have the strength that he used to have pre-nerf from that last patch. So THG grab another kill. That's two for them, and these supports starting to become a factor here. Getting a couple levels because of the kills, because of the, of course, stacking and pulling and what have you. All the while, like you talked about, Centaur not getting ganked. He is too tanky. He has the strength. He is tanky. He's not going to go down, and he's going to have Tranquils as well to combine up with all that. Roaming mid gank here with Nova grabbing the Invis rune, sitting behind the tower as well. Jericho's there. Midas done at 5 minutes. Black of the South is CSing like crazy. Ewo at 32 last hits with 10 denies going his way as well. He's feeling pretty good about himself here. He's going to get some decent farm early on just fine.
Man, that's a really nice quick Midas. I would like to know if maybe it's one of the fastest Midases acquired or not on an Obsidian, you know, or an Outworld rather. I wish we had a stats man who maybe could pull out something like that. I'd love to know where this goes in comparison to all the others. But regardless, in the meantime, Greg, Timbersaw in the top lane eating a little bit of punishment. Has to be careful. You already got picked off once. Can't afford to get caught off again. He's, you know, handing over a lot of time for this Luna to build in the farm. She's second, though, in comparison to the OD. But she can be definitely a stronger presence in the late game. But it'll just pretty much come down to if Union Gaming can begin to snowball out of control, it's gonna be hard to contain the power.
I'd agree with that. They do have a very snowball-heavy team. They get some OD ults going through. They get some Arcane Orbs. They'll probably fight a lot earlier just because that's the team they have, and Luna's going to take maybe a bit more time to get online. Razor maybe needs one or two items like a mech to go through, but they still have a pretty early team fight team as well with the, of course, Centaur. And the issue is here, you know, is your Luna going to farm a bit more than that Razor, or excuse me, than that OD is? Luckily, the Luna picks up an early kind of Helm of the Iron Will, so going for the Helm of the Dominator, where you'll see other carries go for a Midas, this is Luna's kind of Midas item. Go for the Helm of the Dominator, dominate the creep, get into the glaives early on, and then go for it. Now, Citadel, Hastrun coming up top with that Elder Dragon form. There's the Dragon Tail on GSX. Telekinesis Shackles, they didn't combine up. The Eclipse is flying through as well. Citadel gonna go down. Too aggressive for from Union Gamers mid laner. Now you can see Timbersaw getting caught out of position. Nice rotation from Nova. They have to back off now, otherwise Neo would go down, but still they pick up a kill, and that's definitely more than you would expect, I'd say, come out with that rotation from Union Gamers. So
yeah, it's a bit of an unusual rotation you don't see typically often. We were kind of predicting more Dragon Knight would just hold his own in that lane and wait for an opportunity to go for the tower, but yeah, 10 seconds short. I knew it was pretty quick. Thanks, Greg, for the brief little update there. But we were expecting Dragon Knight to kind of hang tough in the lane, but he tried to make something happen in the top, and he walked himself right into an Eclipse, and it just went very bad very quickly. And they're still trying to get on the board themselves. It's 0-3 in advantage for the houses down.
Yeah, and I'm glad that he got rune control and everything, but now he's actually down a level from that of the Razor, and the Razor's got almost a mech here. So not only did he miss out on farm, he missed out on experience, and really just fed a kill essentially to the opposing team, including the Luna. He gave the kill to the Luna as well, which is a bit problematic. So Citadel not even at shreds yet, and you can see, like I said, 1987 rushing that mech. He almost has it. That'll be a very quick mech in about 9 minutes, maybe, at the latest, I'd say. But now maybe a gank coming up top. Union Gamers, they want to shut down this Luna. It's going to be difficult. There's going to be a hero roaming through. GSX is going to be a bit late to the party. Nova coming through, being aggressive under the tower right now. They have a creep wave here. Paws coming through. It looks like Nova might be disconnected. We might have some lag issues coming, but that's the third time, drink of the game.
Yep, everyone, if you're playing the Peruvian Paws game, throw back your next alcoholic beverage. It's starting to get a little fuzzy right now as we're going to see another Paws come out.
Yeah, so it happens from time to time, ladies and gentlemen, but it's Dota. Mm-hmm. It happens. Hockey's.
I do want to acknowledge, I do love the little trinket pickup that a lot of Centaur Warners like to get. You know, he grabs up the Tranquil Boots. You know, if ideally you're in the situation where you're going to build up some extra farm real quickly, you just go ahead and drop off the boots on the ground, put in some last hits, and then when you can return back to the boots, you can get all that sweet, sweet, delicious health regen back.
Yeah, and you actually see a lot of people do this, and not just the Centaur Axes, like to do it in the jungle. They pick up the Tranquils, they, put them down, get some last hits, get some counter helixes, pick them back up, and yeah, it's a great pickup. I love Tranquils as an item, but all while this is happening in the bottom lane, GSX is trying to counter ward and is going to get picked off, surprisingly enough. There's going to be the ensnare, the Riptide, the Aether Shock's going to go. He's actually a bit speedy, but it's not going to matter. He will fall in the end to the DK, getting the kill with the Breathe Fire. Nicely done there. They committed four heroes to it, though, so they're not picking up that much for that squishy support. And actually, there's a huge stack. This is going to give them a big boost. This is what they wanted, and oh boy, are they going to get a lot out of this.
Very nice. Nice little turn back for Union Gaming right now. They spring the trap in the top lane and prevent them from getting the easy counter ward, pick up a kill for themselves. Dragon Knight picks up a kill after, recently feeding in the top lane, and they get the sweet, sweet stack right there. And now making his return back to the mid lane where Razor's been holding strong, trying to get a bit of farm for himself. He's 46-6 as far as CS, and now has acquired the mechanism at about 9 minutes in.
Yeah, and it still looks really good for THG, despite losing that stack, despite losing that hero. And you talked about how Citadel was going to try to put damage on the tower, but it was actually 1987 doing that in the mid lane, and that tower is already at half health. That is problematic. You do not want this tower to go down, especially as a DK. This is your base to farm and try to push into that tier 1 tower on the opposing side of the river, and he's not doing it, as you can clearly see. So 1987 is the one dictating the pressure here in this mid lane. All the while, though, top lane is getting maybe a potential gank setup here, as Union Gamers are sitting behind Jericho's here, as well as the Nagasaira Nova roaming through, but now maybe looking for that top rune spot. Bottom lane, they're kind of leaving Iwo to his own devices, and if there's one thing Union Gamers can hang their hat on, it's the fact that this OD has 68 last hits in Dyer's 9 minutes and a Midas, and pretty much a 4 staff and treads already done at about 10 minutes in, which is a disturbing amount of farm. So that's pretty nice.
And I'm assuming that once he does complete that 4 staff, that's when you can see him get the party started. That's the initiate tool. He typically likes to rush in there, catch someone off with the Astral Prism, of course, and drop the hammer, if you will, and really bring a lot more momentum in his team's favor. So even though THD are leading right now 3-1, I feel like Union Gaming have a lot going on. They're brewing a lot of momentum right now, and they'll be able to get the ball rolling. And Nagasaira, she's looking to get that level 6. The sleep would definitely be a very nice tool to have in a lot of these fights. And all the meanwhile, the house is down, smoked up here in the bottom lane, sitting back, seeing if they could do another bait attempt here with the Centaur in the bottom.
Yeah, and Iwo, he's going forward right now. He's got to be careful. He wants to CS. They don't see this coming just yet, but Centaur is here. He's going to back off now. He's playing this real well. I don't know if Iwo saw it. They're pinging out right now, but that's the, of course, Blue does ping in there, and it looks like they know Faka as well as GSX are nearby. So smoke gank might have gotten caught out there. So
that was, really distracting, Greg.
Yeah. It was.
Is the all caps necessary, Greg?
He's only 2 CS short of the most creeps
killed
in 10 minutes.
You always only 2 CS short of the most creeps killed in 10 minutes.
That's pretty good, though. That's, like, really good. That's pretty nice, I guess. But that doesn't seem right. I guess if you're counting for denies as well, that makes sense. Maybe not. I don't know. Maybe I'm crazy. I don't know. I'm sure that's probably correct. But Astral Imprisonment is going to come through. They're going to lock down Centaur. The Zoidberg is going to double edge. He has Stampede. Evil cannot farm because of his gank train here, but this gives room now for, of course, the Timbersaw and that top lane to go. And actually, of course, Neofolk just to stay in the jungle and farm a little bit as well. So, I don't know. There's a lot of things happening on the map, none of which are resulting in kills right now at 11 minutes in. So, we'll see what happens.
We'll see what happens indeed. Timbersaw does finally acquire the Arcane Staff. Okay. Thank you, Greg. And now probably looking to build forward into the Bloodstone potentially. You know, he's still got to get to that snowball factor. He hasn't really contributed a whole lot as of yet. He is having the opportunity right now to farm it up, but it looks like, yep, Citadel's going to get caught out right by the creep camp. Pulls out the dragon form, but is going to be shackled up and potentially brought down here. Needs a little bit more time. He's pulling out the survivability. Nice Shallow Grave steps in by Dazzle. He's looking to make a run away from it. One more auto attack. No. He will end up falling, trying to take the Rubick with him. But now Rubick will TP and go away. Oh, Dazzle, if he would have stepped up the hill, he could have killed him potentially with one right click. Oh, well.
They were waiting for him to walk by, but he made a smart play. TP'd out immediately. Didn't want to get picked off. Excellent play from THD to grab the kill to back off and not lose a single soul. Even though that Shallow Grave was so on point from that Dazzle that it almost, like, maybe gas, man. He almost really just saved his life, but he wanted to be aggressive. He wanted to run at him, and unfortunately, just couldn't get anything done. Even couldn't get that Rubick kill. So back into it, 4-1 right now. 12 minutes in, the gold graph looking like it's even here. The experience graph going the way of THD, but experience isn't everything. How's the Luna doing? She's sitting on her helm with a Dom. She's sitting on her treads as well. But what about that OD? Four staff, very close.
She's got the Helm of the Dominator, but we need to see a creep. We need to see these Ancients being stacked if that's going to be the case. We want that side reliable farm to fall back on if we can't find it in the lane. For now, she is, though. She's looking to push in this top lane. Still got a tier 1 standing if they want to try to take it down, but action will continue on the mid lane. As Citadel popping out the Dragon Form will lay out a couple of right clicks on this mid tower. They're hungry for a little bit of extra gold. We do have a bit of rotation on THD as they might consider defending this one. There's the rotation to come out. Nice lift to catch. Timbersaw going to try to slow him down with the Chakram, but not be left. Tremendous lockdown coming out in Citadel. Grave, temporary saving him, stepping back. Nice stun. He will be able to get away here. Pops a little bit of a heal. Rotates back. Astral Imprisonment will shut him down. So good work, Union Gaming, able to get away from that pickle. But THD do hold strong. Now long rotation up. They want to get this Timbersaw and they catch him. Unable to get away.
Man, it was looking real bad for THD for a second. They couldn't get a kill, and they lost their Rasta, but they do pick up the Timbersaw there. Nice Eclipse, nice Stampede as well. That Shallow Grave coming through again, saving Citadel's life. He has to back off. They cannot get tower damage done right now, but they're still working their way towards whittling down that Tier 1 tower. Citadel's Dragon Form is done here. Faka will take the Breathe Fire, a big nuke to be sure. For, of course, that Rubick who just gets level 6. They're going to try to clear this creep wave and put in some damage on the Tier 1 tower themselves. They'll back away, maybe looking for another gank here, this time on Ewo. Double H is going to fly. They do have that Astral Imprisonment coming through. His Forest Staff is done. So ganking Ewo is going to be very, 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 very hard. So we'll see if they can get it done now. Right now, the top lane still farming away is Neofolk. And yeah, just farm central. A couple Dying kills going a couple different directions. But as it stands, it's just farm central here.
Yep. A little bit of more slow-paced action happening here. Dazzle looking to move for him. See if he can scout that center. That will not be the case. Counter ward coming out here. Dazzle thinking about making, you know, contesting this, but he can't do it alone. Now that the ward is down, we will push forward and hunt through the jungle right now. Dazzle on the run. Does he have the ultimate to work with? Nope. 19 seconds till it would be available, so they can't quite pull the trigger to make a move on it. Instead, they're kind of scouting out potentially this bottom lane. Lots of pings flying out. They're all scouted. They know that they're around. They're hanging back. Dragon Knight doesn't even want to be a part of this mid lane just yet, so for now, just kind of slow pacing it, and there they will show themselves in the mid lane, maybe thinking about cleaning out this tier 1 tower.
Yeah, they have level 6, so they're going to use the Master Serpent once maybe to take this down if they need to. Fortifications coming through. It depends on what GSX wants. They're going to throw it down. There they go. Now, Jericho nor Union Gamers can defend this. They can try to deny it here, but it's not going to happen. Shadow Shaman gets the last hit. Nice play there, but now the Serpent Wards are down. Stampede as Neofolk is getting ganked in that top lane just to make sure he survives. TP up coming from the Razor. He has an Invis Rune. Now, PMJPS, he might be okay. Is there Song? No, Nagasaren still level 5. Might get 6 from this creep camp. Will he? No, still very low in terms of getting that. There's the Lucent Beam. Neofolk has no Eclipse. The Glaive's coming through. There's the Hex up. Faka TP'd up. PMJPS, now he's getting locked down. They have the Static Link going. He's in trouble. Now, OD's gonna come through. Sandy's Eclipse not grabbing any kills, but doing some damage. Our 1987 in trouble, getting low. So is Neo. They're turning it around. Nice Brave. They pick up one. They pick up two with the Shadow Wave. GSX, he's the third to go down, and Iwo grabs the kill. All the meanwhile, Faka has to back off. Nice rotations coming in from Union Gamers.
I'm assuming Luna did not have the Eclipse available for the majority of that fight, as it's just getting ready to come off cooldown right now. It definitely would have been a valuable asset to have in it, but they didn't. So Union Gaming able to come out on top and come out on top pretty hard right there. Three-man instant takedown. I believe they might have lost one. Did they lose one? They lose none?
I think they lost. They lost the Naga for sure, I'm pretty sure.
Lost the Naga, yeah.
They lost Timber, but he got Shallow Grave, so...
A very nice save. He's been throwing out some very good shallow grades this game thus far, so good work on his part. Centaur's been finding his own farm in the meantime on this bottom lane, looking to push in where the tier one does stand. It's pretty low on health right here, but we'll see if he's able to take it down himself. Very low, double edge of creep, run back, why not, right? There is a DD rune on the bottom lane.
A little bit of scene going on from Color Guy. Resident
Feeling a little soulfish, you know, a little soul right now.
Yeah, I got you, man. I got you. They will deny that top tier one tower. Luckily, not providing a whole lot of gold influx to UG, which is great at this point. But that last fight for Union, I think, got him back into the game. I mean, it wasn't too far away anyways. It was only about 1,000 gold going the way of THT. Now it's about 500. So Slippery Slope going through with this golden experience graph, and it continues to climb and fall as the game continues onward. And now it looks like THT, they want a tower of their own, and this tier one about to fall. This is going to be the second tier one of the game for THT to be taken. It looks like Luna is going to get that last hit. So despite the Midas coming through for the OD, he's not as big as he could be at. He needs like a level 2 Sanities, which he just got not too long. He's got 1 point in the Arcane Orb, and they're going to try to pressure this tier one tower, but that means they'll have to try to TP back and defend this tier two. The wards are up. This is going to be tough. This might not be the best trade for Union Gamers right now.
Yep, there they go. They're going to quickly pick off the tower. The wards are beginning to do work. If they can focus on the tower now below half light here, Luna is ready to fight. She already spent her money. She got the BKB with that tower pickup. It's coming right to her right now, so they might consider making a fight happen if they look to defend, but regardless, that's not the case. Two towers for one. Nice trade going in favor of the houses down.
Yeah, that just seems to be the case with almost every fight or every tower trade in the game. It's just THG are getting more based on what Union are getting. And Union, they had that one fight up top just a couple of minutes ago, maybe even a minute ago or so, but that's it. That's really all they have going for them. Other than, obviously, Iwo farming like a monster. I mean, like you saw the stat from Greg, he's one of the most farmed OGs at this point in the game in competitive Dota. And he'll continue onward. I mean, he's sitting on that Midas. He's getting towards a BKB. There's a Stampede coming through in the mid lane. It looks like maybe 1987 was getting picked off. Missed the beginning of that engagement. However, it doesn't matter. There's not going to be any more aggression yet, but hold on. What are we gonna see here?
There, we got Dragon Form ready to go, level 2, if they want to finally push forward and take a tower themselves. It's pretty much back and forth we go. While the Serpent Wards are down, we're going to make a push with our Dragon Form. And when our Dragon Form goes down, you're going to use your Serpent Wards. Regardless, though, Centaur makes a jump in, but gets blown up in his face, eating a lot of damage. Desperate Shallow Grave tries to save the Naga, but it will not matter. And Centaur falls as well. 2-for-2 trade, though, as they even things up. BKB popped here on the Luna. She's looking to push forward on Cinderall, who has a big DD to work with, but now stunned back with a little bit of a Lucent Beam, and they're going to just end it on that note. So some supports for an offlaner as well.
Yeah, it was a decent trade going the way of UG, only losing their supports, whereas they grab the Centaur Warrunner, who's decently far in net worth, I think. I mean, he's up there. He's not too far behind most of the top-tier carries and, of course, the cores in general. You mentioned the DD rune doing a lot of work for Cinderall there. I think the tower did go down, I believe. It looks like the DK got the kill. They want to re-engage, though. Neoko getting caught way out of position. Next going to fly. Keep him alive, but only for a second. Now PMG Payas is going to be taking a lot of damage, but he's backing off. Cinderall now taking that static link going. There might be an Astral Imprisonment. There it goes. Loses 56 damage. Not that much, but still doesn't have much right-click to work with. He does, however, have the Breathe Fire. There's the Stampede. Cinderall getting low. Do they have a grave? No, it's on cooldown for 2 seconds. Can he use it? Does he even need to? Stomp comes through. Evo double edge Jericho. He's got to use it on himself now. He's backing away. 2-for-1 trade thus far. Looking okay for UG re-engaging. 1987 getting caught out of position. Razor will get the bomb. Jericho, but he will die in the end to the Naga Siren. 3-for-2 trade when it's all said and done. Well, maybe not yet. Stomp coming through. Zoidberg wants Nova. Is he going to get it? Double edge. Not enough. Nice stick charge coming out from the Naga. There's the ensnare. Zoidberg getting too aggressive. Going to fall maybe to one more right click or the urn. Nice. Should do the job.
Oh, Naga. That dirty little urn at the end. That definitely made it a much, much better for Union Gaming in the end. They take down pretty much everyone in the end. Both cores fall. All the meanwhile, Cinderall on the back end. Moves up to the top. Takes down the tower. TP's out of there. Union Gaming, though, now taking control of this mid game.
Yeah, and honestly, just I think maybe some poor play coming up from THG, being too aggressive when they didn't need to be. After the first fight ended, when the BKB for Luna was down, they probably should back off. There's no tower to really try to get. There's no tower to try to defend. They just needed to say, listen, that's it. We're done here. Especially considering when you're a Luna that doesn't have a Yasha early on, you're kind of fighting around your BKB charge. When it's down, don't do anything. Just sit back, farm a bit more, try to get that Yasha and Mantis style up, and that's not what they did. So they lose her, they lose a couple other heroes, and now Union Gaming are in a position where they are tied up in terms of gold, at least for the most part.
And I like this, I like this.
Yeah, that's they ward up here in the mid on the ancient stack mid lane. There's a bit of a aggression going through as DK picks up Faka, getting out of position there. Also down bottom, GSX shackling up Jericho. Stomp's gonna go through double edge to finish it all off. A 1-for-1 trade, but he got the ward up there on the ancient stack.
It was a given that there was going to be something happening right now. Once we spot out the Luna and she has that Helm of the Dominator, it's only a matter of time before she finally does start, you know, stacking up those Ancients for herself. And now they quickly throw down the ward. I don't think they knew that that he threw up the ward while he was there, but regardless, it's up now. They're going to try to prevent her from getting all that extra side farm. Now moving forward, they want to try to get into this Tier 2 tower.
Yeah, and honestly, they have the Dragon Form going through, so this is going to be big. Big Stomp. Ewell has that BKB. He's going to get Hex Tower before he can use it. Song of the Siren disengage coming out right now. Does Ewell want to fight this? It's his choice here. If they want to go, they will. He's going to pop the BKB. GSX getting obliterated. Sanity's Eclipse hitting on 2, I believe. How much damage did it do to Neofolk? Not that much. He's got to use his BKB. He hasn't used it yet. About to go down. Forgot to pop it. Sanity's Eclipse was stolen by the Rubik, I believe. Not doing anything. Missing the mark. Zoidberg getting caught out. He's done. Telekinesis. Met goes Citadel now, getting low. BKB not ready for him just yet. They all back away. And an interesting fight coming through.
Union Gaming definitely coming out on top, getting a quick couple of pickoffs for themselves. Very, very nice. And man, oh man. Yeah, Rubik managed to get a hold of Sanity's Eclipse, but just kind of threw it on his own teammate. I'm not too sure what happened with that one, but didn't really land anywhere too significant right there. And man, Union Gaming doing some serious work right now, looking to fall back as I think THG now need to kind of second guess what their game plan might be.
Yeah, I mean, they really have to kind of rely on this Luna. And I understand she didn't want to pop that BKB charge. She might have lived if it were the case, but maybe not. So I guess holding it might be the better choice here. Still at that 9-second duration, they've got to fight around her, though, and they have to make sure she gets farmed. She spent a couple of minutes now without getting too much CS and getting too much farm. So it's really the onus is on her just to make sure she can get through and actually get some decent CS and, of course, carry this into the late game. On the other side of things, the OD, he's doing as much as he can right now. He has this BKB, he's got a Mystic Staff, so Scythe Device will be done soon, or Shiva's Guard. More likely that Scythe Device, but I don't know, man. I feel like you feel pretty good for UG until maybe, I mean, even if you get some farm for Luna, her BKB might get lower later on into the game, so it's not going to matter anyways. You just wait out the BKB and there you go.
Yeah, her survivability over time will begin to dwindle away as the seconds on that BKB go down. It's definitely a great point to make, and OD's been the MVP of this one so far, leading the front net worth chart 1300, but we get the ultimate. They're making a move on the bottom lane here. Trap out Citadel with the wards, very nice. Shaman almost hands himself over. Now he might with the help of the Chakra Man, the Timber Chain. Here we go, Timber Saw looking for more as he potentially, Zoidberg will make his escape. No, Razor shows up. Puts out the whip, but it will not matter. He quickly TP's out of there. So nice one pickup on Citadel. THD showing a breath of life right now.
Yeah, and he actually used his BKB for that as well. And that was a great ward trap because they weren't locking him down. The only thing, he was running. I mean, he was fast, but he was running too. So that was a moving ward trap, essentially, coming out from GSX. Really well played there. All the meanwhile, it looks like THD, they want to continue this aggression. They're looking for Ewo. He has that BKB, you know, mind you, so keep that in mind. You have the Blink Tech for Centaur. He's ready to go, but Ewo might get caught out. We'll see. He's got his OD ult off cooldown in about 7 seconds. He's getting very close to level 16 as well, but here we go. Will they go on him is the question. Blink Stomp might be the initiation. There it flies. Double Edge is going to go through Telekinesis as well. Do they have enough damage? It looks like they do. He's going to use his BKB, but he is going to fall. Trying to get that Astral off. He could not do so. He had his 4-step as well. Getting caught in a position. Not able to use it. Now he's going to try to Timber Chain away. The Timber Saw getting caught out. Nova stomped up. Double Edge killing him. He's dead. Buyback coming out from Ewo. They're going to try to turn this. Stampede. THG want to continue to go. Maybe not the best idea. Mech is up. Shallow Grave's going to go. Ewo 4-step forward. Astral's going to fly. They immediately bring down the Rubik. Can they get any more? Timber Chain further. They smoked up. Zoidberg just missing the Chakram. Blink away. Mech goes. They force the buyback. They force the BKB. They force the Sanity's Eclipse. They get nothing really out of it other than that Rubik. And they'll head mid for whatever reason.
Well, they gotta make use of this buyback. I mean, they can't make it all for nothing. Immediately picking out, thinking about they might be going for the Roche instead. I think a bit of miscommunication, but in commitment. But now they're gonna look to go for it. I mean, if they're gonna force the issue and try to make the buyback and make the best of it, they gotta look to move on. A pickoff on Rubick is not enough. Roshan would definitely help out, but Centaur's nearby. They're scouting out. They know what's happening. He has Blink on lock and ready to go. I think they could scout this one out. There's the jump and the weave. Here we go. Zane's Eclipse will fly. Let's look to rip them all apart right now as Zoidberg will end up being taken down. Ewo hanging strong right now, but is four steps away. Can he get away? No, he will not. Neofolk picks up a double kill for himself, but he's trying to man up against Cinderall right now. 1987 jumps in, lays out the whip of the BKB to try to take him down, locking him in place. Roshan, in the meantime, hammering away on him. Locking him in place. 2 vs. 1 in the pit. Dazzle and Rubick are having their own little support battle on the high ground as he's looking to make a rotation up to the north. Razor's going to commit to fighting the Roshan instead as they're looking to push forward. They do end up taking down the Dazzle. A 4-for-2 trade as it looks like THD are going to clean up and take out the Roshan.
That was maybe some real questionable decision making from Ewo. He didn't have his BKB. Yes, the Dragon Knight did, and they could have won that fight, but I think they relied way too much on that Shallow Grave. It wasn't really enough, and also coming through the Luna, providing a couple of quick kills with that Eclipse, doing a lot of damage with the Glaives as well, and all of a sudden, a Roshan going the way of THG, who were originally in the lead, and they actually took a bit of a beating in the mid-game, but now it's back to even again, so
oh, yeah.
It's all over the place with this graph, as you can tell. We have a pause again. Take a drink, ladies and gentlemen, while we've got a second.
Throw one back for the pausing Peruvian squad. But yeah, just like that, this game's back even. Those two, that's the pickoff on the bottom lane, and then they had the fight going in their favor. They picked off the OD. OD bought back. They only got the Rubick. And then they tried to make something of it and go in the Roshan pit when it was just not the smart move. It ends up not working out in their favor, and now we're back to even again.
Yeah, and honestly, this game shows no signs of stopping. And now I'd say if maybe Ewo played a bit smarter there, I think they take this game. He does have the highest net worth in the game. He almost has a scythe. He's getting very close to it if he doesn't have it already, and it looks like he doesn't. But it's becoming sort of a questionable game now because the Razor and the Luna are going to start doing a lot of work. That Yash is up. The Mantis is coming soon. There's a point boost on the Razor once he gets his Aghanim Scepter. That's going to be pure mayhem pretty much wherever he fights with it. So 19-18 the score, a disconnect coming out from Nova. That's 4 in this game alone. So this series may take a while to end. It is a 2-game series, so there is no third game, even if this game goes to that, you know, of course, 1-1 tie. We're going to jump back in just a second. Reminder, guys, this is the American Dota League. Obviously, you can pick up that ticket for $3.99 in the Dota store. It comes with that nice black monolith HUD, I believe. And, of course, shout out to our sponsors, SteelSeries. Make sure you check out their products, the H1, of course, the Sensei and stuff like that. But it's Mont and Kobla Guy for High Ground TV, bring you the action here on twitch.tv/AmericanDotaLeague, and honestly, it's been a good one so far, Cattle.
Yep, be sure also to check out our website, highground.tv. Lots of great content available there, an interview with Bulba, our sorts of really cool stuff. We got a lot of great writers on our team, and just a nice team to work with, so it's been a lot of fun. It's been a great start of a project, and so far today, we've gotten some great ADL Dota, great North American series previously, now moving to the South American scene. It's been a little bit, you know, some hiccups along the way, but overall, we've had some really good action. I mean, what we thought was going to be a very lopsided game here, coming into Union Gaming, like, really taking control, and now we're back to square one once again, so can't complain too much.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with you. I mean, even if there's a couple pauses here and there, even if there's a couple of misplays with the lobbies and what have you, this has been a really fun game to watch, and it will continue to be, I think, up until the end. So as it stands right now, we're pretty much even here. The Roche did go for THD. They have the Aegis now. The last fight did go for them, so they have the momentum. One thing they don't have is they don't have map control. You look at the wards across the map, the Radiant have everything covered. They've got this nice aggressive ward in the jungle as well as that ward in mid and a ward on the Ancient stack just to get vision and make sure that's canceled out and, of course, not able to be stacked. On the other side of things, the Dire only have one in mid and one over on the Roche pit. No aggressive wards coming out. They want to control the map, but that's not going to be the way to do it as it stands. So yeah. It looks as if right now, THG, they want to do something with this Aegis, and why not? They've got it ready to go. Let's fight.
Yep, and to start off a great fight, we're going to have a smoke come out here. THG looking to push the high ground with the help of the Centaur ultimate. They do the lift pull back on Naga. She won't even have the opportunity. She's Sushi now as they rip her apart, and they're going to push down this mid lane. Now going to a 4-vs-5, and if we look at the buyback chart, you can see Naga, no buyback available, so that precious Song of the Siren will not be available if they do engage into another team fight. But yeah, it looks instead they're going to just try to take this maybe tier 2 tower in the bottom lane.
Yeah, absolutely. And at this point, you do have to start thinking about buybacks. I mean, we've already seen one this game coming out from Ewo. And honestly, this is going to be a bit hectic here. The Aegis is going to provide a big boon for THT, but it depends on what they do with it now. They're taking the enemy team jungle, and I love that, but also while that's happening top, the tier 2 is getting pressured here by the Timbersaw. They can't really put any much right-click damage on it, but luckily, you do see Union Gamers getting something off the map while this is all happening. They're not just sitting in the base, they're not just waiting to defend bottom, they're moving around, they're splitting up and farming here. So, smart plays. 1987, he's gonna lead, you know, at the front with that BKB and with the point booster as well, getting very close to that Aghanim Scepter. He's got the Aegis on top of that. Everyone's heading up to the top jungle. It looks like UG want to force a trade right now, and that's actually interesting. I don't know if they've got the push to really deal with this.
I mean, we still do have the Shaman wards to fall back on, so I don't know if this is a gamble you want to take right now. I mean, they're looking to push the high ground. He's going to throw down those wards so fast your head will spin. So they're looking to push the high. Let's see. Union Gaming, there goes our first TB, and there goes the wards. Now they're looking to fight strong. Rubik pushing right in. His Timbersaw might be caught out here. Lift to throw back. There goes the song as Nog is back from the dead once more, doing what she does best, trying to assess the situation. Now Sigurd looking to move in. The weave has popped out. Big Sane's Eclipse as they quickly clean up and take out the Shao Shaman. Centaur is the next to go down as they begin to defend the home base right now, trying to force F away and avoid any more danger coming out from this Razor as he's going to town right now. Very low on life, still has the Aegis to fall back on. Neofolk getting a lot of damage on the way out. She has no Aegis for herself. Eclipse to fly will be enough. Shallow Grave will save for now. The Lift even temporarily saving her, but it should not matter. One more right click will take her down. Breath of Fire takes out the Rubik as well on the run back. Razor very low, same with Neofolk. One Force Staff, he should be able to catch up, but it's got 15 more seconds before he can catch up, and they will pull back. 3-for-3 in the end. They lose the tower, but that's about it.
What was that dive? They had one job. You hit the tier 3, you hit the racks, and then you back up. I don't know why you're like over here, or like here, or like even like here, even like over here. Like, you need to be like here, hit this thing, then back up. Like, you don't need to be diving the base, guys. I mean, I understand that you're fighting because the song of the siren, you want to use your abilities and all that stuff. Listen. Objective gaming comes first in Dota. It always does. Fights and kills will get you something, but if everyone has that, I mean, even if they have buyback, or even if they don't have buyback, I mean, they still can come back in and they can defend the racks. If you're not going to get kills especially, it's going to be problematic. So they are a bit too aggressive. They kind of trade the fight. They get a tier 3 tower, that's fine. They didn't lose the Aegis, that's also fine, but still not the best play coming out from THD, I think.
In the end, I guess they get a little something for themselves. The tier 3 tower, a little more gold. Now they're pulling away with the gold lead for their team, about 4k it looks like, and moving on past that. And now we just have to look to sit back and assess the situation here. Do we wait it out for the next Roshan before we make something happen? Do we wait for the wards to come back up and then look to push on this bottom? It is, you know, to note that Xiao Shaman is actually going for a BKB himself, so I guess they're really priding on the fact that he will be able to lock down potentially either the OD or the Dragon Knight, and they don't want anyone to contest that. So they're looking for some heavy CC action here.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's what they need. Even if with the BKBs coming up from a lot of the team on, of course, the Radiant side, with Leo getting one, with Silverall getting one, they're getting in low duration now. So it's going to be about lockdown here. And in fact, that's going to be, I think, the key point for both sides, is the Scythe Device is now done for the Outworld Devourer. They're going to try to push down bottom. They still have that Aegis up for Razor. Not for too much longer, however, maybe a minute or so. They're going to try to catch Nova out of position. He does have Song, Blink, Stomp. There's going to be a double X potentially. Hex might come through. Shackles, nice, Shallow Grave. Can they take Nova down by the time this is all over? So there's going to be the Serpent Wards coming through. Force Staff to the low ground. Nova's going to survive. Serpent Wards wasted up on the high ground for whatever reason. Now OD going to town on GSX. Free kill there with the Arcane Orbs and the Hex going through. And all of a sudden, it looks like THD maybe a bit. Radiant's wait. Courier has been okay, killed. Radiant's Courier died to a Serpent Ward, I think. Wait, where did that die?
No. Ryubor has just got an item drop for that Courier kill. Are you kidding me right now?
He doesn't deserve that, really.
He absolutely does not.
Right here.
Anyways, that was a very questionable ward drop happening. I don't know if he just anticipated that the whole cavalry was going to be coming over that hill, or if he maybe misclicked or whatever, but now the wards are down. A bit of a misplay. Union Gaming get a quick pick off in their favor, and even the spread happening. Citadel looking to push in this top lane. You know, he does have the dragon form if he wants to try to make something happen, but instead they'll just kind of try to push out the top lane and create a little more space for themselves.
Yeah, and you can't fight this if you're THG. You have to go back and either defend. I mean, it doesn't matter because they don't have their Aegis anymore. It just got reclaimed. So without wards, without the Aegis, you cannot fight high ground, especially against Evo, with the Sandy's Eclipse up. So all of a sudden they make a bit of a mistake. They kind of lose the time they had with that Aegis, and now they have to go back and farm for a bit longer. And I don't expect them to push in until they're really ready with either all the lanes pushed out and the Serpent Wards, or until Roche is up. So I think Roche is going to be the next objective coming out for THD, and if not, I'd be very surprised. They'll have Neofo continue to farm. He's going to have his Butterfly next, I'd imagine. He already has his BKB and his Manta, but his farm isn't all that great. I mean, OD, it's a bit more farmed than this Luna is, but is that going to be enough for Union Gamers? They didn't lose a set of racks yet. Game's certainly not over, but back and forth we go.
Yeah, I mean, and just depending on how the fight or pickoff could go, I mean, either team has such tremendous pushing power to really fall back on. You could lose a full set of racks in a blink of an eye and not even know what you're dealing with anymore. So for now, though, they're just going to play very slow, very methodical, probably wait out for the Roshan to come back up and maybe see if they can make a fight happen. I would feel like THD are more comfortable in going into the Roche pit and taking a fight there with the help of the Eclipse and everything, and if they can congest them and, you know, throw down the wards in an opportune time unlike last time. But we'll see if it works out in their favor. For now, we're just going to see a lot of footsie, a lot of illusions going out from both sides, the Manta over here and Naga scouting out the illusions over there. So for now, just very slow paced.
Yeah, and it's going to continue that way. I mean, teams are going to try to push out towers, push out lanes, try to get tier 2 towers, try to kind of force TP rotations, or just try to get a few free tower here or there. Well, that's happening, obviously. I think that the one thing to note is that if they decide to fight, if 1987 decides to fight, he did just receive that Aghanim Scepter. So that is another key item that you kind of have to think about in these engagements and see, okay, well, where's it going to go from there? On the other side of things, UG, they have Weave and they have a lot of armor to go through. And as the game goes later, armor is going to be more of a high value. And it looks like they know this. They're going to go for tier 2 tower, at least pressure, and maybe force some TPs. They have the Nagasaran Song to, of course, you know, not just... They need to use that and kind of just get the hell out of there if that seems to be, like, if there's a fight that's going pretty much poorly. UG, you're going to have to look and see, is that not going to use the song? I'm going to wait to find if there's going to be a fight here. All the while, though, 1987 is split pushing. It's interesting.
Yeah, split pushing their own lane, seeing if they want to pull back. He's happy to sit here. You know, he has the ultimate fall back on for some heavy pushing power, and finally one does bite. It will be the OD to go back, and now THC see that. They're looking to push forward and see if they can catch anyone out. They won't, but on the retreat out, this is a decent opportunity. Nope, Roshan's not going to be up, not just quite yet, so, you know, they're going to have to... Oh, wow, really aggressive jump in here. Zoidberg really wants to get a hold of someone, but on the run right now, these... Dragon Knight still moving away. Look at this man.
No, just relax. Just relax, Zoidberg. Get back.
Don't take it easy right now. We got it. You got cojones. Yeah. All right? You don't need to show me them.
Listen, you're alone. Your team is nowhere near you. If you die, they'll be yelling at you in chat, and you will not like that, my friend. Trust me when I tell you this, and you will feel the pain of every Dota player who's been flamed.
And caster. We get yelled at pretty frequently, too. So.
That's true. Yeah, absolutely. So, listen, just don't do it. Back off. Roche is going to be up in, like, now. It's actually up now. So, as I say that, it's going to be up now. They're going to go into Roshan here. They'll take the Roche real quick. They'll get another Aegis. It might be contested, but I don't know if they can get there in time. Union Gamers are not necessarily too close. You do have the OD there. You also have the Timbersaw as well rotating nearby, but Citadel's not there, nor do they have the Dazzle. And we will see kind of the Dire team posturing around this Roche pit here. They're looking to try to enter it. They're looking to try to take it down as quickly as possible. Neofolk right-clicking it down. There's the Serpent Wards used. It's pretty short cooldown, so not too bad. Meanwhile, Timbersaw getting caught out of position. He'll take the creep wave first, and they'll run away. All the rest of the Radiant team are grouping up. They're getting close. They want to maybe contest this. Roche is falling low, half health now. Who's going to jump in first? They have Song of the Siren. They can try to fight with Song. BKBs might come out if the Song does get popped. It's getting low, however. BKB goes. Citadel wants to fight. That's GSX's BKB. Full duration. Neofo caught in the pit on the other side of things. Now, Razor going to town. Oldio grabs one. Zoidberg going to go down. Roshan goes. Aegis picked up by Neofo. Eclipse is flying through. GSX getting caught out. Jericho. Nice shallow grave. Neofolk still alive. GSX is going to fall. Neofolk has that Aegis. Here we go. Fable, no. The right click coming through. Breathe Fire is up for Faka. Now, Telekinesis is in back. Citadel going to fall with the Urn on. Song a bit too late to save his compadre. And now they will get the hell out of there. No Sandy's Eclipse, no Song. Now it's THG's time to fight. There's no Stampede ready to go. They're getting closer, though. Nova, you are not that fast. That's a questionable decision. You're very dead, my friend. That was not the Yule set. You will die so that others can
That is not the engagement you want to do when you want to contest a Roshan. There's commitment issues from both parts. Citadel trying to duke it out in the Rosh pit itself, trying to see if he can nab up the Rosh or Aegis for himself, but couldn't quite get it. Luna popped out the Eclipse. They had Dazzle nearby as well to help out, but it just did not matter, and they end up falling and now pushing in. They want more. They're going for the Timber Saw to lift the pullback. He's on the run, can reactive armor and a Timber Chain help him. Centaur calls out the War Run. They run right through him and take him apart. The machine will fall. Same with the Rax right here as Neofolk does work with the Glaives. Fortification. Dazzle steps in. Happy to feed over another kill as the Rax will fall. All by the power of the Eye of the Storm coming out from Razor.
And Ewo's trying to do the same top, but unfortunately he's getting caught out. There's the Hex up. The Serpent Woods as well. The Stomp. Ewo has that BKB. Is it going to help? Absolutely not. Double kill coming out for the Zoidberg, man.
Oh, Ryu boy. Just got another item.
This is rigged, dude. I can't cast this.
With a ticket he bootlegged off. He did not pay for that ticket. He hopped in the booth spot, took that ticket, and took away two items from other people. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to contest Ryu in those item drops, go ahead and get $3.99 out of your pocket and buy the ticket right now and get that sweet, sweet HUD.
Yeah, also, Ryu, you're going to have to fork over those items if you want to have a shot at casting my friend list. That's how it's going to be, my friend. You're just going to have to start contributing around here. And it's just got to be like that. Otherwise, you're stealing from other people's items.
Absolutely. At least donate it for giveaways, right?
Yeah, I agree 100%. Okay, there's going to be a lot of lightning happening very soon right now as 1987 picks up the Axe Refresher. That is not impossible to deal with, but seizure warnings are going to be coming soon, I think.
Yes, a definite caster nightmare. And I do want to touch back on a stack rig throughout that. It's a 70% win rate for an Aghanim Scepter on Razor, but I do want to question if A, that is from 6.8, and if it is, how many times have we even seen a Razor picked up in 6.8? It can't be that tremendous of a number, at least I think so. But the smoke to fly out right here, you know, Rubik's not going to be a part of it, but they're looking to see if they can hide out in the trees
without
being spotted out by the vision of the...
Where is this Razor going?
Is it the grocery store?
Maybe, yeah. He wants to farm a bit more. Just get some more produce, if you will. But he's sitting with his team. They decide to rotate with him. I think they want to enter on the backside. There's no wards here. They could just run uphill and fight, and they might do that. Will they? Zoidberg's going to run up. Smoke of Deceit about to wear off. They're looking to blink on somebody. Oh, Citadel. Citadel, no. Citadel, don't jump on Citadel, man. It's going to be Citadel. Jump. There's going to be the other dragon. They have the stomp. There's going to be the Hex up as well. Warren's up on the ground. And Sandy's Eclipse does fly. I don't know if that hit on anybody. Song of the Siren is going, but there's so many BKBs. It doesn't matter. Nova gets picked off. So does GSX. Citadel trying to do work. 1987 leeching all of that damage. Shellgrave is up. Zoidberg getting caught in a position. Now, the Aghanim's Refresher is going. The Storm is starting to do some work, my friends. Citadel getting low. He has a lot of armor on him. As you can clearly see, the tier 3 went down mid, I believe. Nova bought back. 1987, lightning striking every which way. Song, Stolen coming out. Nice song from Faka. This is what we were talking about in the draft. Telekinesis on Ewo. There's the Lucid Beam. Now you can see Timbersaw maybe in a lick of trouble here. Yule Scepter up coming out from that Rubik. PMJ getting chased down. He's very tanky with that armor. Now the Arcane Orb's doing work. 1987 getting caught out. They dove too far. All the while, they take a set of Rex at the very least, but they're losing the fight. Four down. Aegis is now going through Neofolk. BKB is up in 6 seconds. He's got to run away. His Mantisal, he could try to turn this around, but it'd be very questionable. Now, there's going to be the Stampede. That'll help him out. Will they be able to chase Zoidberg? He's got Blink in 6 seconds. It looks like he will fall, however, to the Whirling Death in the Chakram and Timber Chain of the Timber Saw. So they take 4 kills there, but they lose another set of racks.
Man, and that Razor, it's something we haven't seen in a long time. Razor been picked 46 times. That's actually a much higher number, by the way, than I was expecting for a Razor pickup. I feel like we don't get to see him very often, unless it's in this kind of situation where you want to direct counter someone like the OD. And he's putting in serious work this game. The Refresher, Eye of the Storm, it may be a bit of an eyesore for a lot of people, but it does serious work. He just dove past the tower in the middle. Off on his way back, just conveniently the Eye of the Storm happened to clear out the tower for him. He didn't even have to give it a dirty look at all. But top lane, they're making a move here. Neofolk might get caught out here. Ewo trying to work one more auto attack, gets it in, eats a hex coming in from Shao Shao, but it's a little too late. Throws out the wound, the wards rather, traps him up. Self astral, can he get away from this right now? He does not have the four staff available just yet. Nope, will not matter. Ends up falling. Man, Shadow Shaman himself gets a redemption kill for the Luna.
Yeah, checking out buyback right now. OD, no buyback. He just used it. Luna does have hers, and She's ready to go again. They'll wait for another Rosh, I imagine, and this game one is going to go a bit longer, but at this point, Union Gamers, there's still two Rexes down. They don't have a Nova Nagasarn to hang their hat on. It's just going to be a support, so no carry items there. You can't really push in with that. And you have to deal, like we talked about, the Agnum Scepter, like we talked about the Refresher Orb, Eye of the Storm. So suddenly it becomes very problematic as THG, they might just want to push down right now. They'll have Serpent Wards up again not too long from now. Wow, that's interesting, actually.
Mott, Greg, everyone, High Ground TV, congratulations. The first debut also of the Refresher Agnums on Razor in 6.8, casted by us.
We've done it. We've done it, everybody.
We've done it.
We've hit the
achievement unlocked.
Exactly. So with that Refresher Agnums, when do they look to push in? Luna's up in 14 seconds, so not too long from now, I'd imagine. Probably won't wait for the next Roshan. It's still a ways away from being up, but... they just couldn't get anything done with that OD pickoff, unfortunately, because that Luna was down. And he'll be up in about 34 seconds. So unless they get into that bottom lane and try to find somebody out, I'm surprised there's no, like, wards or anything placed outside the base just to make sure they've got vision of anybody. They do have this, I guess, Ubercliff ward, but is that...
You gotta remember also that Rubick does have a gem. So any ward they want to get up, Rubick's going to be right there to take it right back down. They're going to congest and suffocate them right back into the base and not allow them to get anything going. And if they do want to adventure out of the base, they got to get that buddy-buddy system going and stay close and tight like they are right now in the mid lane.
Yeah, and this is what we call the five-man formation. Five-man Dota being played here. The Luna's sticking around here, going to come through down to the bottom lane as well. And like you said, there we go. Rubick counter-warding. Just that easy. Just that easy. Okay, this is an aggressive play from the Timbersaw. They're going to have to back him off there. He does have a four-staff, so getting away is not really an issue. And maybe they're going to look for the last set of racks. They can't really go for tier fours. They might just take a fight altogether, but you got to give it to UG. They're not willing to go down right now. They know what's at stake. I mean, it's the first game of the season. They don't want to start off poorly. Here, of course, in the ADL, $10,000 prize pool on the line. That'd be a big boon for any one of these teams, and obviously a victory will help them towards that goal. So we will see. THG and Union Gamers now fighting a good fight here.
Yeah, and you know, we don't know for sure if how much pull it will have, but a good performance in the ADL could also help them out maybe at the international time. I don't know if it'll make them look better for the qualifiers, or if they get in there, they want to build up a strong fan base for themselves going into the qualifiers, you know, what have you. So definitely want to put on a strong showing nonetheless.
This isn't like TI2 or TI3 when you know who the top teams are, you know who can get those qualifier spots. It's a little bit more jaded. I think it's a little bit less cut and dry. There's a lot of spots for teams that have been doing stuff in JDL Europe and, of course, JDL in America, the Star Ladder stuff. I mean, there's a lot of teams out there that can surprise people. I mean, teams have been upset before. I mean, Sad Boys, they've been taken down by the likes of E-Hug, I believe. I mean, it happens from time to time. Things go people's ways. I mean, sometimes you have a good Dota game, sometimes you don't, and that's just Dota in general. So we'll see how these teams fare in this tournament. I mean, obviously, this is the starting point right now, and they're giving us a good one as they're sitting right around Roshan. THD ready to go for this, ready to take the Aegis up, and this will be Aegis and Cheese.
Yep, an easy Aegis and Cheese, mind you. Don't even need to obviously bother wasting the wards or anything. Just kind of go to town, man. Look at the size of that chicken. We'll be eating for a month.
Those legs, man, that's going to feed a whole team. A whole team. And we're talking about a Centaur Warrunner, too. Like, he's going to be munching on those things, but it's not going to matter. He's going to have help with that.
Luna. I'm sure the Brazilians love their chicken.
Oh, absolutely. They definitely, I mean, well, first of all, who doesn't love chicken? Let's be honest.
That's true.
We have Luna leading the way now. Well, actually, it's the Centaur Warrunner leading the way with Stampede. They look very similar when they're smoked up, but Luna's going to be not too far behind with the Eclipse, with the Mantis Style, and with the Butterfly as well. Zoidberg going to jump in at a moment's notice. You have UG, PMJPS, he's ready to fight. Jericho the Bomb, hashtag the Bomb Jericho. He considers himself the Bomb. That's a fair statement. He's had some good shell graves this game. Buyback status, nobody for the rating team ready to go on that front. And no one is even close in that matter. They just need one good fight to go the way of THG and they will take this series. So they've got to be a bit defensive maybe in this. They're running right up onto the high ground. They're not even going to go for that 2 or 3 top. They're just trying to take these huts and moonwells down in the Radiant base. And they're not even going to come in from the side potentially with GSX. They're trying to split push, or at least just take everything down here, clean out. They're going to look to push tower down here. Meanwhile, Evil getting caught out. Elder Dragonform being used on the backside, coming out from, of course, DK Citadel. The tier 3 tower getting broken down. Citadel looking to jump in. There's going to be, of course, Dragon Tail, the right click and the Breathe Fire. Neopope's still fine, though. They are going to get weaved. That's a lot of armor going the way of UG. The armor swing real nice, but there we go. Aghanim's Scepter, Eye of the Storm, no refresher just yet. Now Dragontail in 1987, he has cheese, he's got to use it now, he can't. They're getting caught out, BKB, this is not the fight you want for THG. They take the tier 3 tower, Neofolk, there's the H. You've got to back off now, THG. Buy that coming out from, of course, that Razor. He's gonna bot sit. Now Eclipse is gonna go for Neofolk, trying to right-click everybody down. Evo is doing what he can, Neofolk in some trouble. Zoidberg, stop in, there's the Shallow Grave, nobody else is low. Zoidberg about to go down. THG, they're losing it, they're throwing the fight away. Everybody going down. On the backside of things, you have the Razor going to town on the throne. You can see the Eye of the Storm doing work. The base race is on, I guess, if you will call it that. The Serpent Wards are up as well. The fortification already used. 1987. He is doing work alone. Is it enough? He's got to cheese. The Eye of the Storm is now splitting up. It's not doing damage to the tower. He's trying to right-click it down. It looks like he will. That's going to be it. GHD at the very end to have an awful fight. But just by sheer brute force coming out from the Razor, they are able to take the victory in maybe one of the most questionable late games I've seen in a while. Nonetheless, they get it done. What a great series, man.
Yeah, unbelievable. And THG, you thought first that they were being a little greedy and, you know, overzealous, trying to push in that top lane, but it was just a ploy. All the meanwhile, the dirty little Rasta and the Razor jumping right in, they're throwing out the ultimates, taking down the throne, and they get it done. Wow, props to them. Sheer iron will as they right-click it home. Timbersaw trying his best to bodyguard it up, but it did not matter. First game, it was a long one with a lot of little pauses on the way and nearly 50 minutes in, but it will be all THD.
So THD securing the first game in a two-game series right now for the ADL, sponsored by, of course, SteelSeries, brought to you by Highground TV. Make sure you follow us, guys. Check out highground.tv. A lot of interesting content. We have that Bulba interview up and ready to go for you guys. A great read there. Make sure you follow us, twitter.com/mockdota2, twitter.com/coddleguy, twitter.com/highgroundtv, and a big thanks to our stats man, of course, Greg, twitter.com/whatishiptv. So we are going to jump into a quick break, guys. We'll jump into game number two. And un momento, we'll be right back, everybody.